We all search for that spark which fuels our desire to fully engage in our lives. We look for the courage to experience moments where we can come alive instead of watching life pass us by. You're listening to The Front Row Factor, leaving fear and insecurity behind by exploring stories of top performers that are living life in the front row. Get ready to stand up, step up, and live it up with your host, John Vroman.
Hey, hey, Front Row family, John Vroman here. I am so excited that you're with me for today's show. We're talking to Tucker Max, who is the co-founder and CEO of Book in a Box, a company that has turned book writing and publishing into a service. If you have ever thought about writing a book, you're going to love this show. As an author himself, Tucker's books have sold over 3 million copies worldwide. And while today we're not talking about his books, we are talking about the books that he's helping others to create. This show is a lot of fun. We get into a bunch of cool stuff, including how to shift our internal beliefs about our personal value in the world, the process to get ideas out of your head and start helping others with your wisdom, and what may be standing in your way of getting that done. We talk about a critical moment when a quote-unquote devastatingly, precisely correct call out brought about the birth of Book in a Box. I ask him why he's putting all of his energy into this new project versus any of the other opportunities that he has in front of him, which are countless. And I ask Tucker, what would your 20-year-old self be positively surprised to see about your current self now? And he had a great answer to that. And he also had a comment about what he would say to his 20-year-old self, which I thought was really great. You know, when doing this show, or even thinking about the start of the show, I decided not to travel down the road of exploring Tucker's earlier life that made him famous, his books and his blog posts. You know, some people have very strong opinions about that. And I will tell you that I can understand why that would be. I decided not to go there because of a couple reasons. One, you can find a bunch of information out there about Tucker's life around that time. You know, there's great articles written and there's great interviews. I really enjoyed the show that Rich Roll, if you don't know his podcast, it's excellent. He had an interview with Tucker and I would go check those out. But I decided not to spend time there, partially because, you know, I don't want to harp on Tucker's life at 20 years old. I want to talk about what he's doing today, which I think is pretty awesome. You know, I don't agree with or condone all of what Tucker wrote about earlier in life. And the truth is, I don't agree or condone the activities that I, you know, was doing at 20 years old in my life. And thank goodness that people aren't holding me to that because it's allowed me to evolve as a human being and to focus on what I can do for the world now. Not some of the poor choices that I made earlier in my life. So today, you know, I really enjoyed this conversation with Tucker. And I really think that what he's doing with Book in a Box is great for the world. And I want to explore that. And I think you'll enjoy my conversation with Tucker today. Let's get to it. All right. We've got Tucker Max on the line. What's up, Tucker?
What's going on, man? Thank you for having me.
Dude, I'm just so glad that you're outside right now.
Yeah.
I mean, this is perfect. So when did that start? You said you like to do these podcasts outside. I totally get it. I'm going to start moving my business outside. Where did this all begin?
Yeah, it's a good question. I don't know. I live pretty healthy. Like I take a pretty strong interest in making sure that, I mean, because it's so easy to be healthy. Sleep 8 hours a day, eat the right things, exercise a little bit, get sunlight. Like you do that stuff and you've got 80, 90% of what you need to do to be really healthy. Since I work from home, I own my own business. And, or I can't work from home or I work for our office. The only time I'm ever outside is like, doing sports or whatever, right? Or walking my dog. And I realized I was doing all this phone conversations sitting inside. I was like, well, I can be outside getting sun and enjoying myself. I live in Austin, Texas, where it's like sunny, you know, 300 days a year or something. So I was like, why not just be outside where I'd rather be? Yeah.
It's so smart, man. So smart. I do an afternoon jog every day around 3:30, and I just started having calls when I was doing these light jogs through the woods, and I was some of my most productive conversations with our team. It was that 45 minutes.
Yeah, well, there's actually Dude, there's a lot of data that shows that people think better when they're moving and walking. There's actually a lot of studies about that. A buddy of mine who's a college professor, he piloted this weird study. And I'm like, there's no way that's going to work. And it ended up working really well. He learned Chinese. He tried to learn Chinese just normally, studying, like a normal way, flashcards, whatever. It worked okay. He started studying Chinese, the same stuff, while on a treadmill. And he ended up 3X-ing his retention. And so he actually did he's a research psychologist. He did a whole study about this to see if that effect replicated. And it didn't 3X and replicate, but 2X replicated across a massive group of college students.
All right. So for anybody listening, if I start to sound out of breath, it's because I've started jogging in place as I'm talking to Tucker. Dude, that's awesome, man. So cool. I am at a standing desk. I'm not outside, so I haven't gone to that level yet, but I am at my standing desk. And that's made all the difference ever since I got this thing. I'm literally sitting down maybe 15, 20 minutes a day at best.
Yes, that standing is great. But the next step then is walking.
That's
I don't know about walking desks. That always seems weird to me. I feel like stand up or sit down, whatever, do your work and then go outside and walk. Like, so part of what I love walking is like you're kind of letting your mind wander. You're just thinking about other things. You're not doing two things at once that don't go together always seems weird to me. Talking and walking totally go together. But like, but trying to type and walk is like nonsense.
That's awesome. Hey, Tucker, take us back a little bit, man. I want to go to childhood. Can you give us like a few seconds on who you were growing up? What life was like for Tucker as a kid?
Obviously, we could spend the whole podcast on that. Like, what kind of angle do you want on what answer, type of answer are you looking for?
Enough where people get a small taste of who you were 0 to 18. That's maybe an impossible thing to do to sum that up.
No, it's not impossible. It's one of those things where you'll see. All right, so 0 to 18, my parents were both iconic baby boomers. Like the dumbest generation of narcissists that have ever lived. My parents could have been the poster children for them. And not bad people, but very bad as parents. And so I were divorced when I was like a year old, totally self-absorbed. So I basically, I don't want to say I grew up alone. It's not true. I was not like I was ever starving or anything like that. But I kind of basically, in a lot of ways, raised myself, or I had to. So a lot of my childhood is, quite frankly, and I say this like just as a matter of fact, not even going one way or the other, it's kind of very lonely. It wasn't like abusive the way you think of abuse, like someone getting hit or like sexually molested or something awful like that. It was just sort of like neglect, but sort of rich white people neglect, you know?
Yeah, sure.
Not poor person neglect, which is like someone chained up in a yard or something terrible. It was just like I didn't have a lot there, coming from the people who normally bring it in. So I ended up having to create sort of my own life, even from a very young age.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely. Yeah, 100%, man. It's interesting is I talked to you a little bit about this prior to going live with the show, but it's like there's so much that we could talk about your life. It is obviously just rich with places to begin, massive amount of conversation, and it's all fascinating to me. But one of the things I want to focus on, Tucker, is how I got introduced to you was by what you're doing now, which is Book in a Box. And I'm fascinated by this idea for many, many reasons. And congratulations, by the way, because you're crushing it. I was at Mastermind Talks days ago, and I swear Book in a Box was mentioned more than any other person or company at all in those 3 days.
Yeah.
I was like, this is incredible, man. Like, Book in a Box has gotten a lot of play at Mastermind Talks. But I know why, because I'm familiar with the organization. I told you as well that one of my best buddies, Hal Elrod, is using Book in a Box for his next book.
Yep.
My buddy, John Rulin, is using Book in a Box. And I know about 8 other people using your company. I'm blown away, man. So from the early days to Book in a Box, what I'm most, and I want to get to Book in a Box and I want to talk about that because there's so much there. But what I'm also fascinated by, Tucker, is transformation. And in our community, we call that the back row to front row moment of life, where you move from kind of being checked out of life, not that you ever were, but I consider that somebody who's not very close to what they want in life, what they're inspired by. And I consider that the front row. When you get close to what you want, when you go to the show you want,
right,
that idea of proximity that's so powerful in our world, Dude, can you take me to a time in your life that you think is one of the most transformative moments for you, where you really found what you were born to do or what you were destined to do?
You want to hear the weird God's honest answer? I'm not entirely sure I've hit it exactly yet.
Oh, that's good.
No, I mean, like, I know I've done a lot of cool things in my life, but I have this weird feeling, and this could just be hubris, it could be nonsense. I have this weird feeling that when the story of my life is written, when I'm dead and gone and my kids and other people who knew me and loved me write the story of my life, I feel like what I've done to this point will be super interesting prelude to what's coming and what I'll eventually do.
That's fun.
Yeah, that's a weird way of answering your question. The most transformative moment I think I may have... Let me actually talk about the question itself for a second, right?
Yeah, love it.
There's always this narrative that people have where it's like, because we see it in a movie, right? There's the hero and he or she is a certain way, and then an event happens, and then all of a sudden they're magically a different way, like just right away, right? And so there's, I think, a narrative in a lot of our heads as people, we think, well, I am a certain way and I want to get to either another place or be a different type of person. And so there has to be some event. And so they almost wait for something to happen.
Yeah.
Right? That's just not the way real change works in people. I mean, every now and then someone has a near-death experience, and that really truly does. That really is a catalyst for change or whatever. I mean, dude, I could tell you a lot of stories about this event or that event or whatever that were catalysts for change in my life. But in a lot of ways, man, I feel like that real change is sort of like going to the gym. You know, if you're 50 pounds overweight and disgusting, like out of shape blob, there's no one trip to the gym and no rep that you do or weight that you lift that makes the change.
Right.
It is the accumulation of everything. And if there's a moment, it's the moment that you decide to commit to the change. And then every time you make that decision to keep up with the new habit, you know? And so I feel like the narrative around change for a lot of people is really destructive, because most people don't change. And I think the reason is because instead of talking about how do you build habits to become who you want, people talk about like what event happened. I'll tell you exactly in my life. So I'm going to answer your question, but sort of differently. I think for me, in 10 years or 20 years, I'm going to look back on meeting my wife and starting a family, a life with her and a family with her, as being an integral moment for me, right?
Yeah.
I mean, we've been together 3-4 years and we have a son and another one on the way. So like, I can kind of see it, but it'd be a little bit foolish for me to talk about it now. But instead of talking about that moment, I think the better discussion would be, how did I get to that moment?
Yeah.
You know, how did I meet? Because like my old sort of books, and there's sold millions of copies that kind of made me famous, were all about drinking and hooking up and being single and doing all the, you know, sort of dumb things that guys in their 20s do when they're single and in their 20s. And that was great. I had a great time and it was fun. But how did I kind of get to you like to talk about transformation. So how did I get here?
Yeah, right? That's right. That's exactly right.
Dude, I'll tell you, with my wife, it was one of those things. It was a series of things. Like I eventually got tired of just playing, you know, the single hook up with girls, drink a lot game. It just got tiresome. It wasn't even a moral judgment. It wasn't fulfilling anymore. And I wanted something deeper, more meaningful. And so then I started trying to date girls seriously and it wasn't working. And so it was kind of funny. Like I asked my, this is when I was in psychoanalysis, my analyst, I was like, I don't understand. Why isn't this working? And over a series of conversations, basically we figured out that I was looking for a different result, but I was going in the same places to look for the same type of girls, hoping to get a different result, which doesn't make any sense, right? So we came up with a plan, and it was very simple. She just asked basic questions. What type of woman do you want to date? And so I created like an avatar, and then it was like long and ridiculous. And she's like, okay, let's make this a real person instead of a fantasy. And so then I had to like narrow it down and realize there were three things that really, truly non-negotiable. And then three other really important things I'd like to have. Right. So the three non-negotiable things were, she's got to be wickedly intelligent, at least as smart as me, maybe even smarter would be nice. then she's got to be really, really sweet and just caring and compassionate and a genuinely kind soul. The third one was she's got to be hot. At least I've got to think she's really attractive and I've got to be really attracted to her. And then the three that I kind of would have liked were like, I was like, I can't even remember, but she ended up fitting them. But so anyway, I took those six things and she's like, all right, what are these women doing? Where are these women? And so I came up with like 20 activities or places or jobs or whatever that the type of women who would be like that would be. And then she looked at the list of activities and she said, okay, here's 20 activities they would be doing. Which of these are you doing? And it was like, oh, because the answer was zero.
Exactly. Yeah.
Zero.
Yeah. Huge. Yeah. Huge.
Right. And so here I was saying I wanted to change, waiting for change to happen, but not actually doing anything.
Yeah. That's
like
right.
I wasn't actually, but that's the funny thing, man, is that me, I mean, I am always doing stuff. Like I'm the opposite of a entrepreneur. I have too much stuff going on. So it wasn't even like, I wasn't willing to make the change, and it wasn't that I don't create action. It's that I never sat down and systematically thought about how, like, what change do I want to happen? And am I working in the ways necessary to make that change happen? So of those 20 things, I then picked five that I liked, that I was into, because not all of them I was into. And, I just started doing those things. A great example is like CrossFit. I work out. I don't need to go work out with a bunch of people and be told how to squat. Like, I've been working out my whole life. I'm good at it. I know how to do it. But here's the thing. The woman I wanted to meet, high likelihood she would be doing CrossFit, right? So if I go work out and CrossFit and I insert myself into that community, who are a lot of really good people, the type of people that I like and hang out with, then I'm going to double, triple, vastly widen my social network. And if I don't meet my wife through CrossFit, I'll have a great opportunity of meeting someone who knows the woman I want to meet. Right?
Couldn't agree anymore. Yeah, totally.
And that's, there were about four or five other things, but that's literally exactly what happened.
Yeah.
I started CrossFit. I mean, it's fun. Like, I wasn't like, oh, it changed my life. It didn't change my life. Like, it's kind of funny. Like, they have the little intro program thing for beginners in my CrossFit that everyone has to go through. And I ended up smashing the record for the intro, whatever, the little workout you do when you're a beginner. Because most people, when they're beginners, they're like out of shape or whatever. I was already in great shape. So I destroyed it. It was like, okay, whatever, right? And then I ended up becoming good friends with the coaches. And they introduced me to this woman who they worked out with. They used to work out with. And turns out that becomes my wife.
Yeah, that's right. It's perfect.
Right. So, but telling that story, where would I say the sort of seminal moment is? I'm not sure. It's not, there wasn't really one moment. It was like a series of moments and then a commitment to a certain type of habit change.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, 100%, man. 100%. Yeah, the way I see that, when we talk about living life in the front row, our framework is there's the three elements of it's a relationship, it's an environment, and it's a mindset. So we always talk about who's in your front row being who are you getting yourself close to? And so you put yourself in the front row of a bunch of people that are doing things that you would value in your future wife, or your environment changed. You went to the gym.
Exactly.
So that's the what's in your front row. That's just, it's what's close to us. And we can't help but be affected by what's surrounding us, like why you're outside. And then the other piece is people believing that they deserve a front row seat in life. I think a lot of people don't meet the woman or don't do the thing they were born to do because they don't believe that they deserve it.
Yeah.
They don't believe they're worthy of that spot at the gym or that seat at the concert. And so they never do it.
Dude, I'll tell you, I could not agree with that more. It's so weird. I have a lot of problems. That's never been my problem though. And it took me probably 30 years or more to realize that other people had that problem. As a young dude, I used to date such hot girls. And like, I was no better than any of my friends, and they thought I had some magic. You know what the magic was? I went up and talked to those girls.
Right.
And they didn't. And yeah. That was the difference.
That's it.
And that's it. It blows my mind to this day that, like, I get if you're like 5'6", you don't think you deserve to play in the NBA. Okay, I get it, right? But like, so many people, the limiting factor on themselves is themselves.
Yeah.
So many.
Well, dude, in high school, I was a sophomore and I was 4'10 and weighed 85 pounds with the bone age of a 9-year-old. So, dude, I was like, I had zero confidence and would not talk to any woman. And I was, you know, it was, yeah, I was that guy, dude. I did not believe that I deserved a seat. That was my problem. So we were on opposite ends of the spectrum.
And then as you grew?
I changed.
Your internal attitude, did it match your physical changes, or it took probably a lot longer, right?
It started to. Like, as I grew physically, my attitude started to reflect that. So I definitely felt, because I just started to get noticed more. Like, the signatures in my yearbook went from, oh, you're the nicest guy ever, I can't wait to marry somebody like you down the road, to like, or I was just like, I just want somebody to want me. Like, I just want somebody to want to date me. And but I could have owned it. I mean, there was a guy in my class who was a really short guy, but he was really popular with ladies because he had confidence. And I didn't have that. I just didn't believe that I was worthy. That did shift over time. And so my back row to front row moment was probably like the transformation, which, as you say, is a huge process. It's not literally one moment. But if I had to sum it up, it was the belief that I deserved that seat, that I deserved to be in the front row at a show. And then my buddy said, you know, the way to live life is just go to the show where, like you said, like the people that you want to be around are at, and then have a great time. Just be the guy at the show having a great time. And that's just, to me, how I interpreted confidence, which worked out really great.
I've helped a lot of people, not formally or whatever, with this. You know what I learned worked is whenever I come across someone who has this issue, in psychology, it's called the sociometer theory. And so it's basically people, they have a maladjusted way of seeing themselves relative to their actual social value, right? Yep. And it's usually lower. So for narcissists, it's actually higher, but most people, it's lower. So what I do is I just start asking a bunch of questions, right? Like in this example, I'd be like, okay, what do you think you have to do? Someone obviously deserves to be in the front row, right? Yeah, of course. Okay, what have those people done to deserve it? And then you get people to start literally listing those things out, right? Like they pay a lot of money, or they've done these things in life, or they've whatever, right? And say, okay, how can you get one or more of those things? And then you get them to start thinking about that. And then half the time they realize, I've already done more than what I think you need to have to be in the front row. I've just never thought about it.
Brilliant.
And then if they haven't, then there's a clear path for them to get there, and they earn that, and they demonstrate that performance to themselves, and then they really feel like they deserve it. You know what I'm saying?
That's it.
But you got to bring those assumptions forward for people.
Yeah, that's really good coaching, man. I hope people stop and do that exercise right now. That's really good. So Tucker, you transformed, dude, in my mind, into this guy who's got book in a box. There's some transformation that occurred for you to launch this company. And we should take a moment, because I'm so familiar with it, I forgot to mention. Can you give like the short version of what books and a book in a box is for people that don't know?
Right. So basically we turn ideas into books. So if you have an idea for a book and you don't want to sit down at your computer for a year and figure out how to write a book and then go through the process, but you know what you want to say, it's in your head, we basically have a way of systematically interviewing you to structure your book first, then outline it, then interview you to get your content out, then edit that into your words and your voice. We edit it into book prose, and then we do the rest of the publishing and distribution. So book cover, you know, putting it on Amazon, getting in bookstores, all that sort of stuff. It's kind of a total soup to nuts, done for you thing, but it's not ghostwriting because it's your ideas and your words and it's in your voice. We're not adding content. Yep. It's everything you.
Yeah. It's amazing, dude. I'm so impressed by your company. I'm impressed by the people I know that have worked with you. I think Cameron Harrell he's got, right? Mm-hmm.
He's a client of ours. Yeah.
Dude, there's just amazing. And I'm really impressed. Can you take me to the birth of that? Dude, where did the idea hit? How did that all come to be?
So that actually, if I had sat down to write an origin story, I don't think I could have written a better one than our actual real life origin story. So this was not like a long-term thing. This happened quickly. I was at an entrepreneur dinner, and this woman came up to me, and she's like, hey, I heard you're the book publishing guy. Can you help me out? I've had people asking me for a decade to write a book, because what I do is like kind of new and different, and everyone wants to understand it, but you know, my time is very expensive, so like I don't have time to sit down and write this book, and also like I don't really like writing; it's kind of a weird process to me. And how do I do this? How do I get this book out of me without having to go through the normal process? And so this is like two years ago, right? And I look at her, and just a little bit of snobbishness, I say, are you asking me how to write a book without writing it? And she's like, yeah, kind of. That's a little bit really what I mean. And so I go into full elitist writer mode. And I start lecturing this woman about hard work and about what writing actually means and how the process is part of blah, 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 right? And she listens to me politely for about 5 minutes. And then she rolls her eyes out of her head and stops me. And she's like, Tucker, this is an entrepreneur dinner. Are you an entrepreneur? And I'm like, yeah, of course. And she's like, well, I don't know. I'm not so sure. Because she's like, a little stuff. She's like, because I am an entrepreneur. And I spend all day, every day helping people to solve their problems. Are you going to help me solve my problems or just lecture me about hard work?
Wow.
I know. Wow. Right? And it was like, it was so, I actually almost couldn't talk because it was such a devastatingly, precisely correct call out. She totally, and she didn't even punk me. Like, she was just right.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so, of course, I became obsessed with this idea. How do I get a book out of her head without her having to touch a keyboard? And I spent weeks thinking about this. I honestly just didn't think it was possible. I kept coming back to the idea. There's no way to write without writing. And then, totally cliche, most ridiculous thing, I stopped thinking about it. And in the shower, I'm thinking about something else. And it totally hits me all at once. I'm thinking about, like, honestly, I think I was thinking about Keanu Reeves, and then I thought about Socrates. No, like no, because, you know, Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure, right?
Yeah,
something
yeah.
about Keanu, and then I was laughing about how he's never topped the scene where he and Socrates discuss philosophy in Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure. Yeah. And then it hit me all at once. Socrates never wrote a word down.
Yeah.
Consider the greatest philosopher in Western history. Who wrote everything down for him? Plato. Then it was like, oh, of course, Jesus wrote nothing down. His apostles did. Buddha wrote nothing down. His disciples did. Malcolm X wrote nothing down. Alex Haley wrote his book. Winston Churchill used to dictate his books. He wrote the History of England, dictating it to his secretary. I was like, oh my God, what about scribes? And so I kind of pieced this all together in my head that thinking and having wisdom is totally different than the ability to write. But for the last 100 years, those two things have been entwined together for some reason, right? And they used to be totally separate. Like, literally the job of writing down the words of the wise man was for scribes. And so I said, well, what if we did that again? What if we brought those two things back together? How would that be? Because you can't just interview someone and have them ramble for an hour and turn it into a book. You've got to structure their ideas and their thoughts in a certain way. And all that sort of stuff. So I kind of put together a whole process. I honestly didn't think it was going to work. We tested it out with Melissa, and it ended up working amazing. Like, we got this incredible book out of her that she never would have gotten done herself. And it took her like 12 or 15 hours on the phone with us over a few months. And so then, first I was like, okay, that's cool. It worked. That's neat, right? I felt proud of myself. And then I did a podcast like this one. It was Lewis Howes's podcast, actually. And I talked about, it was about a totally different subject. I talked about this for about 10 or 20 minutes because Lewis is very dyslexic. So somehow this came up and I told him about it. He's like, that's the coolest thing I've ever heard. He said, what do you call your company? I was like, what do you mean? We don't have a company. Basically, a few days before, Zach and I had joked that we're going to call the company, or we're going to call the service Book in a Box. Because, like, that's what we were doing. And so I didn't have anything else to say. So I was like, oh, Lewis, we call it Book in a Box. It's like, oh, what a cool name. All my fans should go sign up for this if you want to get a book done. And I'm like, yeah, okay, whatever. Let's go back to what we were talking about. And then the next day, I get an email. And the email is like, hey, where can I find this Book in a Box online? I want to sign up and do a book. And I knew the podcast wasn't out. So I was like, who the hell is this? It was the podcast editor for Lewis's podcast. And I was like, Zach, we got to put up a landing page, man. This thing might actually have legs. Put up a landing page, podcast drops. We did $200,000 worth of business in 2 months off of one podcast. And then Melissa referred a few people to us. And it became this incredible, there was this a massive demand out of nowhere. And so we ended up being like, all right, let's scrap everything else we're doing. Let's focus on this. And here we are.
Dude, can you tell us where we're at now? Like, is that public? Yeah.
Yeah, of course. So we're about 18 or 19 months into. Here's the supreme irony is that podcast, I did the interview like August 5th and the podcast dropped August 20th. My son was born July 31st. So it was like my son and the company are basically the exact same age.
Yeah, that's great.
So the company's like 20 months old. And so a little bit, a year and a half, we've done about 4 million in sales. We've done about 230 and 240 books. And yeah, we're growing crazy, dude. We have 14 full-time employees, about 100 freelancers we work with, different types of freelancers. Yeah, it's going really well.
Dude, the dead giveaway, the new dad talking about his company. He just said, my company's 20 months old.
Yeah, right, exactly.
That's so great, man.
Well, think about it in terms of like,
course, yeah,
my
it's
son.
The link. It's the link, of course. Yeah. That's so great. Hey, what's been surprisingly positive about the company? Is there anything that's caught you off guard that you're like, man, I didn't see that coming? Aside from it's just natural growth and the explosion, like that's amazing. But is there anything else that just caught you off guard as being really great?
Yeah, so absolutely. When we were first doing this, I didn't see it as anything other than we're kind of doing books, right? It was just like, I didn't see beyond anything other than what it was directly. And then a kind of a weird thing happened. After about 10 or 20 books came out, we started getting not just the authors telling us how amazing they felt and how incredible like the feedback was from the books and how it was helping their businesses, but we actually started hearing from like the people who read their books and whose lives were changed.
Wow.
Right? And then what I really started to do is realize that like there's a massive group of people out, because I'm a writer. You know how everyone, like, whatever you can do and is easy for you seems, even if you know intellectually it's not true, there's a part of you always feels like, well, how hard can it really be, right?
Sure.
So I'm a writer. And so to me, writing is easy. Like, if you want to write a book, you can do it. But, like, the total snobby elitism that I said to Melissa, like, that's kind of the way I used to think. And what I forget is that for most people, writing is actually really hard. Yeah. And that there are a lot of people out there who are really smart, who have accomplished an immense amount in their lives, and who have a lot of wisdom and knowledge to share, but they are afraid or intimidated about the process of writing a book.
Yeah.
Because that has nothing to do with being a doctor or being an amazing entrepreneur or being an amazing coach of some sort. The two things are totally unrelated. And I knew that intellectually, I just never really thought about it. And so what we kind of realize is we're not actually in a lot of ways in the book business. We're in the business of unlocking wisdom and from the heads of professionals and sharing it with the world, which is like, once I realized that, and once we've got a year and a half or more of evidence and we're seeing it over and over and over again, it's fucking amazing, dude. It's incredible. And it's cool because it's not about us, right? Like my first part of my career was about me. I mean, I literally wrote books about me and the things I did and nothing else. And now it's like the total opposite. Now I'm the guy behind the stage, behind the curtain, behind the machines, helping other people get their ideas out and impacting the world. And it's like,
how does that feel?
Yeah, it's cool. I should say I don't want to be like one of those people who's like, oh, it's the most amazing thing on earth. I mean, but it's like, here's what was shocking for me. I had no idea that being the guy behind the stage could actually be more rewarding, as rewarding or even more rewarding than being the guy on stage.
Good answer.
You know?
Yeah.
It just never occurred to me that could, I never understood people who were happy being off stage. Part of that is my own personal emotional issues, right? Obviously. But now I am that. And it's like, it's actually really cool. It's really cool to watch not just our authors succeed. What matters to me is hearing our authors talk about the impact they make on other people's lives, yeah. Right? Because like it's not our knowledge, it's not our wisdom. Like Cameron's book and Hal's book, which is about to come out, and Melissa's book, which has been out for a year. Like we didn't insert anything into that. All we did was be a tool, sort of like what the iPhone has done to photography, we're doing to books, yeah. You know? And so we're making people's lives better, but just indirect, just by being a service,
yep.
Instead of being the one doing it. Which is like, it's weird for me, but it's really kind of cool, man. It really is.
I think it's amazing. I remember hearing you talk about on somebody else's show, or I don't remember where, but talking about the Socrates thing and about, you know, incredible people who didn't necessarily write it down, but spoke it out and then or shared it in some way that was then documented and shared. And I thought that was so brilliant. And I just think that what you're doing is incredible. And my hang up originally around the idea was that it's not really a book unless you wrote it. And then I just had to get past that limiting belief and realize that in some ways I was just holding back from potentially sharing the message I had, the whatever gift I was given to share with the world, that I was now not going to do that. And that was selfish to not do that, but to allow that to come out is a great gift. And I just think it's awesome.
Think about how ridiculous that is. If your fingers didn't hit the keyboard,
I know.
Somehow you it's not a valid book.
That's right.
Well, I mean, so let's carry that all the way through. Did you make the computer? Did you program it? Did you actually physically press and print the books? Did you lay them out? I mean, come on.
Yep.
You know, like, what matters is getting an idea out of one head and into another.
So good.
You know, no one would say a podcast is invalid because you didn't edit the audio yourself, or you didn't, you know, you aren't the one hard coding the algorithm, you know, to turn voice into digital and back again or whatever, you know, like, it doesn't make any sense.
It's so good. Yeah. I have other questions, but because that's so good, I wanted to stop it there, but I'm not going to stop it there, Tucker. I want to ask you more, man. This is so good. I want people to feel that. I want people to, like, literally, I hope this right there in the last few minutes, that can change a lot of lives. I think it's brilliant, man. Thank you for sharing that. Dude, let me ask you this. What's a question? Because, dude, as this thing's blowing up and you're getting a lot of questions about it, I'm sure, what's a question either that you're sick of answering around Book in the Box, or what's a question that you wish people would be asking you about Book in the Box? It may be something you're tired of talking about and something that you wish you could talk about more with the company.
I'll answer that by saying, talking about where I think we're going to go, what I think is going to happen.
Oh, so, I love that, yeah.
Because I wish people, with anything, it's hard. No one really sees far in the future. You know, you see, when the iPhone came out, most people, like, either thought it was like a flop or didn't care or whatever. And it took a while for people to really understand what Jobs' vision was. I'm not comparing myself to Steve Jobs. I'm just saying, like, as an example, that's something where, like, I think still 10 years later, we have only begun to see the massive changes the iPhone is going to create for the world by being a platform for other things, right? Mm-hmm. And I think ultimately what I wish people ask me about, but I understand why they don't, is I wish people ask me more about what I saw the future, what I thought the future of Book in a Box is going to be, and why did I pick this idea and this company to focus all my time on? Because I've got more opportunity in front of me than I could ever take. Why this one? And the answer starts with what I said before about helping people unlock their ideas and their wisdom. But I think it's way bigger than that. I think it's way bigger than books, man.
Let's go. Let's go there.
Here's where I think it ultimately goes. I honestly think, do you know the story of the Library of Alexandria?
No.
Okay. So in ancient Egypt, like, the people that built the pyramids were great collectors of knowledge. They used to send scribes all around the world. And they would go to, like, the capitals of all the biggest empires and write down, like, a copy of their libraries and listen to their sages and write everything. They wrote everything down. Every time a boat came to Alexandria, which is the biggest port, it's in Egypt, the biggest port in the Mediterranean at the time, the law was that you had to let scribes onto your ship to make a copy of every book you had on the boat.
Oh, wow.
And they kept all these books in a massive building called the Library of Alexandria. And we have a lot of accounts of what that was like. A lot of Greek and Roman scholars and other people visited. And they said it was the most amazing building they'd ever seen, because every piece of not recorded knowledge and to that point in human history was there. So, like, all the plays, all the great plays of the Greek playwrights, like Sophocles and Euripides, and all, which most of which have been lost now, were all there. And all the works of Aristotle. And I mean, just go down the list. All the great thinkers, all there. And then Cleopatra crossed Julius Caesar, and he's not a man to cross, and he burned the Library of Alexandria down, right? Burned all of it, everything in there, burned to the ground. And what happened was, at the time, nothing happened. But then Egypt fell, and then Rome fell, and Europe was plunged into a 1,000-year dark age because no one else had written down most of the world's wisdom. These things that you don't think about, like, how did they build the pyramids, right? Like, they knew how to do it, obviously. They're still existing. Do you realize it took us about 6,000 years to reverse engineer? How we just figured out about 30 years ago, really, how the Egyptians built the pyramids. The Romans built roads that still exist and aqueducts that are still in use. We figured out about 40 years ago how they made the cement to keep those blocks together. And we still don't know precisely how they so incredibly accurately set the levels correctly so the water flowed downhill for thousands of miles. We still don't know how they did it. We had to reinvent and relearn all of the knowledge that built those massive, amazing civilizations, right? Well, right now, I think we're doing the same thing. The world is awash with information, but very little wisdom and knowledge is in people's heads. Is actually written down either in books or other media. And it's really easy to figure out what the temperature right now in Cairo is. It's really hard to figure out how, if you live in Cairo, how to become an entrepreneur or how to build a business or how to whatever, how to have great relationships or all these things that humans actually care about. Temperature matters, I guess. But what really matters is having a relationship with your family. You know, and we don't record this knowledge and wisdom because it's really hard to do. So what Zach and I really realized over the last 6 months to a year is that we have the opportunity to build the company that is the conduit to go from people's knowledge in people's heads to sort of finished works that everyone else can not just read necessarily. We want to build processes for everything, yeah. Right? So like speech in a box, movie script in a box. Go down the list. Any finished media product, there are a series of steps to turn an idea, a thought in your head into a finished media product, right?
Oh, yeah.
And if we can take, and but right now for any media thing, it's very high friction, right? But if we take the friction from high to low, then what happens is you see an explosion of what's being shared. The amount of stuff being shared, recorded and shared, and also what is being recorded and shared. I think the next step in the information age is the knowledge and wisdom age. And I think we can help accelerate that by creating simple background processes for people to record and share what they actually know. Does that make sense?
100%, man. It's great. Yeah, it's exciting to think about. Do you know StoryCorps?
Yes, I was at TED this year. They won the $1 million prize last
year. Dude, I was just thinking, you're the StoryCorps for books.
Yeah, not just for books, man. I mean, like, books right now, we're going to start going.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm telling you, everything.
That's
we're
so
going to start everything we can. You know, listen, think about it. Songs. Like, there's a process to create everything, right? And most people don't know the process. And the thing that stops most people from creating art is they don't know the skills to create the art. Even if they have a great song in their heart or a book in their head, because they don't know how to write or they don't know how to use a guitar or whatever it is, right? And the standard answer for thousands of years has been, we'll learn the skill. Okay, I don't necessarily think that that's wrong, but that's a massive barrier, right? What if you can just get the song out of your heart without having to learn how to play a guitar, right? Or the book out of your head without learning how to write?
Wow.
Like, what then? You know, it's the comparison I use is the iPhone. Are you old enough to remember what photography was like 10 years ago? Like with film developing and nonsense like that?
Yeah, dude, that was my life in high school for sure.
So you remember like physical film and like these huge cameras and lenses and
absolutely.
I mean, to take a photograph, to be a good professional photographer, take great photographs, the friction was incredibly high.
Yep.
Now, the friction is literally as thin as your iPhone.
Yeah.
You can take the best photographs in the world, basically, with an iPhone. You might need a snap-on lens, right? That's it, though. Like, I mean, you can basically use an iPhone. And what that's done is it's not only 10,000 more pictures taken every day than there were before, but the type of pictures are also totally changing. Right? I have more pictures of my son at 18 months old than of me in my entire life right now.
right, exactly.
And even though I'm a bad photographer, let's say like 100 of those pictures are for every one, every 100, there's only one good one.
Yeah.
That still means there's 100 times more good photos of my son now than there are of me in my whole life.
Exactly.
You know?
It's
and so that's our long-term plan is to try. We've created the process for books. Now we're going to try and do it for every piece of media we can, one by one. And it's basically just one step closer to connecting human minds to each other without the friction in between.
Dude, you've got no shortage of things that you could be focused on right now, man. This is
yeah,
great.
Right.
It makes me appreciate this podcast even more, Tucker. So thanks, man. This is a huge investment on your part in our community and all of our friends. Thank you. Dude, is there anybody that should not write a book?
Yes. If you don't have anything to say.
And not just the limiting belief of I don't have anything valuable to say, but... You know, how do you differentiate between that? Somebody that's going, I don't have anything to say. And then you learn their story and like, that's total crap, man. You have tons to say.
Yeah. So we actually have a doc. We're working on a set of questions for people that they can use on their own. But basically, it boils down to this. Do people ever ask you for advice? Do people ever ask you for help? Do people ever ask you for information in your head? Or do they pay you for information or knowledge or wisdom in your head? If the answer to any of those is yes, you almost certainly have a book in you, right? Also, there's a whole nother way to do it. That's more just direct nonfiction. If you're not sure you have anything to say and you don't have any specific knowledge or wisdom to share, there's another way that you can do a book. If you're willing to be vulnerable and to be emotionally open and to talk about yourself in a way that's open, you probably have a book in you, because I'll tell you why. Everyone wants to open up. Everyone wants to be vulnerable, and almost everyone is deeply afraid to do it. So if you're willing to do that, even if you don't literally don't know anything, you're just willing to talk about your life and your experiences, because that's how we as humans not just connect with other people, but learn about ourselves, is by hearing other people talk about themselves and their experiences. Because that shared connection, that shared feeling is how we create connection. So if you're willing to be open, or you have things that other people value, you objectively value, either one of those, you should write a book.
Brilliant. Tucker, I know that we're running out of time here, man. Do I have a couple more minutes for you?
Of course,
of
course.
Last questions. If your 20-year-old self walked into the room right now and met you today, what would that Tucker be most pleasantly surprised to see right now?
I'd probably have to beat his ass. 20-year-old Tucker was an idiot. He'd be excited that I was rich and famous. Like, he would be excited about the things that I don't really care all that much about now, but I thought were really important at 20.
What are your thoughts on death, end of life? As you know, in our charity, we deal with people who have a life-threatening illness. Dude, is this something you think about?
Oh, man. That's like... Anyone who says they don't think about it is lying to themselves. There's a great phrase from, I forget, one of the great English poets who said that death is the worm at the core of the human soul. Like, almost everything we do in a way is, I think, a way of avoiding that fear and the reckoning of our own mortality. I'll tell you, man, I have a wife and a kid now. We just literally spent $8,000 setting up our estate and all our wills and all that stuff. So I have to think about it. Yeah, man. I mean, the reality is I'm probably halfway done with my life.
Yeah.
You know, and my son is going to see things that I won't see. And he will take the stuff that my wife and I build and hopefully create something even better out of it. Yeah, I have. I've just at 40 started to think about that. But no, I'm not going to lie and be like, oh, I've thought deeply. Yeah, but I haven't, man. I've only just now really started to think about where am I in the course of my life. You always know intellectually you're going to die, of course, but you don't really face that fact emotionally. I think the last 2 years I've started to realize, holy shit, like this is real in a way that I haven't had to think about before.
So if years down the road, your son's grown up and he's listening to this, dude, what would you want him to know about his dad right now at this stage of life?
The only thing that matters between father and son or just parent and child is that you only have to do one thing to be a great parent, I think. And that is to genuinely love and accept your child. You let your child know that you are the one place on earth because they are unconditionally loved. If you do that, you're meeting your requirements as a parent. Obviously, if you can socialize them and teach them and educate them even more, that's even better. But like if they feel truly accepted and connected in one place on earth, then, and that's all you need. You just need that one place. Anything above that is great. And that's amazing, but it's just kind of a bonus. So he just needs to know what I try and do every day is let him know that his mom and his dad love him and accept him. And he doesn't have to do or be anything to get our love. Now, to get love from the world and other people, you got to bring something to the table, you know? But for us, he just has to be. That's it.
That's awesome. So, dude, when it's all said and done, how do you want the world to remember you?
I don't know, man. These are hard questions. I don't know. That's actually a really good question. 2 years ago, I would have given a very confident answer to that I don't believe in at all. I don't know what my answer is now. I'm not sure.
Dude, I like that. That's great. All right, let me give you a fun one then. What live event would you most want to see front row?
I'm not really a concert person. I'm not really a speech person. Probably front row.
Sports? Any sports? Or
I've sat front row in NBA games and I loved it. I would do that again anytime. Yeah. Like I love basketball. I grew up playing basketball. I got played in college. I love it. Yeah. Those guys are the best athletes in the world. And the game is deeply difficult and complex to understand once you know it. It's pretty beautiful.
Tucker, man, I want to say goodbye by celebrating you, brother, and saying that I really want to honor you for this gift that you're giving to the world with the book in the box. Dude, it's awesome, man. Thanks for bringing that to life. I know it's directly affecting my friends and therefore my community. And as I say to a lot of our guests, that I really feel that right now what you're doing, Tucker, is helping the world be a place that's a better place where my kids are going to grow up in. You're affecting my kids because you're helping people to extract wisdom out of their brain, put it into a book, and I think that's good for the world. Dude, I love what you said about unlocking wisdom. And for that, I really want to say thank you, brother. I really appreciate your time. Any final thoughts for the front row community before I say goodbye?
No, man. Thanks for having me, dude.
And bookinabox.com, right?
Bookinabox.com.
Cool. Anywhere else to send people?
No, that's pretty good.
That's all for this episode of The Front Row Factor. To discover more simple and effective ways to lead a fearless front row life, visit frontrowfactor.com and subscribe to John's 4 Minutes in the Front Row, where he shares quick stories from real life experiences. Thanks again for joining us today. We hope our show inspires you to live big, give big, and experience life to the fullest. See you next week on The Front Row Factor.